Good morning, everyone. How are you today? It is the middle of the week, and yes, it's Wednesday. It's the day after Election Day, and everyone is coming up with their why this happened, how this happened. Only God knows why anything happened. So, you know, I am just tired of people doing their, you know, prediction punters kind of thing after it happens. Well, it was a nail biter in Virginia last night because, yes, they Terry McAuliffe's people, they managed to pull it out just as they said. The Quinnipiac poll said 3 to 4%. They were on the money. It wasn't 4, it was 3. I guess by the time they finish counting the other 2% or whatever, it will get to 4%. But it was interesting to see how people were confident at Terry McAuliffe's headquarters. They were confident that they knew that Fairfax was coming in for them. But also, I was moved, totally moved, by the way people were celebrating Governor Christie's victory. Love Governor Christie. Love his hard line. Love the way he speaks frankly. Love how he tells the truth. I don't know if he's always telling the truth, because one never knows if people are ever telling the full truth, because everyone seems to have skeletons in their closet someplace. But it kind of struck me that everyone is saying, oh, 2016 and his speech was inclusive and all those kind of things. But are you really telling me that the 32% of Democrats who voted for Governor Christie in an unfair election, in terms of my view, it was just an imbalanced thing? Bono was there on her own, basically. So it's like David and Goliath kind of thing. Yeah, he won 60% of the vote, but the point is, if you got 32% of the Democratic vote, that should have really gone to this woman if she had gotten the support and the exposure and the media coverage, and if she had the dynamic personality that Governor Christie has, despite his weight or whatever. He just looks like a teddy bear. You know, somebody in the crowd wanted to hug him when he was making his speech because he said he got lots of hugs and he was giving away hugs. But my question is, if Hillary Clinton or Ms. Warner or anyone, Joe Biden, runs against Governor Christie in the general election for 2016, I don't even like to go that far in the future because I like to live in the now and what's happening today. But let's play devil's advocate for a minute and go to 2016. Christie is the candidate for the Republicans, which I doubt he can be because I don't think he's crazy enough to be their candidate. But they'll choose him because he's electable. But Chris Christie, Hillary Rodham Clinton. Now, who do you think those 32% of Democrats who voted for Governor Christie are going to vote for? The woman, the Hillary Clinton, or the Chris Christie? My bet is that they would be voting for Clinton. So I'm not quite sure why everyone is so happy and almost predicting that Christie is going to be the president in 2016, because when you run for the office of governor of your state, the scrutiny, the media probe, the secrets coming out, the 47% words that you might say, Those things only happen when you're running for president. So, ladies and gentlemen, put your hats on, put your shoes on, put your armor on. If the competition is going to be between Clinton and Chris Christie of New Jersey, who is a Republican, who does not believe in abortion, who does not believe in increasing the minimum wage, who takes care of the rich, who may we hear have some secret lady, it will all come out. And how wonderful are we going to love Chris Christie at that time? So let us not race ahead of ourselves. Allow Governor Christie to do what he said and what he promised the people of New Jersey last night. He promised to finish the restructuring, reorganization, restoration of what Sandy left. And Sandy is his thing. Let's see how he does with Sandy, because already we hear that folks in New Jersey who are not in the wealthy realm are not getting any help. So let us see how it plays out before we all jump on the train of Christie. This was done when we jumped on the train of George W. Do we forget what happened to us in 08? Governor Christie, as sweet as he might seem, is still a Republican candidate. And he also said in an interview with CNN, he thinks the Tea Party is good. Some parts of it. Okay, Governor Christie, I am going to tell you that that piece of tape will be run over and over again when you are running for president against the Democrat, whomever that Democrat is going to be. The power of the video, the power of your recorded speech will always come back to haunt you. So as I speak about fair for this week, I now drive you to the thought that though we close our eyes and we imagine the end, and we know what the beginning is because we're busting our butts to get it done right now, like I am trying to get my book sold, my t-shirt sold, my message out about the loving yourself, my book, Deadly Negligence, to tell you how much when you go to the hospital you can get killed there, and everything else that goes with that. Being in the bed 45 days and you have no insurance, woo! All those things are in my book. The education system that you have to fight, who wants to keep your child disabled, basically, because they don't want her integrated, and you have to fight for that. And then you have to fight the legal system who try to make you look like you're crazy. So let us not forget that though we see the moment here now, and we see the end, 2016, and we see Christie versus Clinton, there will be hell in the hallway in the middle to get there. Let us watch that. And we think the Tea Party is dead because McAuliffe won in Virginia? No, they're not. They're still out there spewing their hate and their evil and their disdain for other people who are not like them. So why are we in such glee today? Should we ask that question? Welcome to the Diana Wright Show, live, 10:30. It is Wednesday. We're supposed to have Dax normally, but Dax is at a seminar. We don't think he's going to join us today. So we'll continue on this vein of dissecting the politics. 32% of Democrats voted for Governor Christie because he thinks they voted for him because he tells the truth and all those good things. But I promise you, if Governor Christie is running against any Democrat for president in 2016, those 32%ers are not going to vote for a Republican. I promise you that. And the primary season between Christie and Rand Paul and Ted Cruz, the government shutdowner, and Marco Rubio, the not-so-telling-the-truth kind of guy? It will be hell in the hallway before we get to the end. Because yes, for local elections, midterm elections, like the governors that will be elected in 2014 and the senators and everybody else, because that's the norm. Virginia tends to do things at the odd times. If I were a Democrat, I would not be too gleeful at the moment. Because you see, the Republicans are riding the wave of Obamacare failure. So what if, just let us say what if by January the Affordable Care Act website is running smoothly? Because President Obama has pledged that he will not be campaigning for any more offices, but this is his campaign to secure his legacy and make sure it works. And I see his intention is not about politics, as everybody's saying, and he's a weak leader and all of that. Yeah, he might be. But this is his baby, and he's going to make sure it rides. And there is no other campaigner that is better than Barack Obama. So even though you're talking about his, you know, his ratings are going down and all that, yeah, what goes down normally comes back up. Because I am positive that President Barack Hussein Obama is not defeated. The Affordable Care Act is not defeated. He is going to his bed every night, thinking, sleeping, breathing, digesting, eating, and drinking Obamacare. I promise you that. He said it, and I know he's doing it behind the scenes. He's just being quiet. Now Governor Christie says that, oh, President Obama, well, he's not a great leader because he should have just come out and said, well, I misunderstood the whole law thing and I made a mistake. I think he's kind of said sorry a couple of times already, hasn't he? I thought I heard that. So then I switch over, before I finish with the American politics, I want to switch over to Canada and wonder how the people in Toronto are feeling today after their mayor, who just downright lied about the fact that he was a cracker. So the code was cracked that he is indeed a crack smoker. Yeah? And he sat there in front of the camera months ago. I saw that. They repeated it yesterday several times, but I saw it originally because I'm a news junkie. And he sat there and he said, I do not smoke crack. He was only willing to tell the truth when the police in Canada said they had the videotape of him actually doing it. Now who? Yeah, Phelps did it. But which politician is not wise enough? I don't care where you are in the world as a politician. Which one of you are not smart enough to know that if you're going to be smoking a crack pipe, you don't get it taped? There should be no evidence. Should there be? So we see that politicians lie in Canada. They lie in Saudi Arabia. They lie around the world. And they lie in America. Oh my God. Can we ever find somebody to tell us the truth? Politics for me has just gotten unbearable. Because I never knew in my lifetime that I would see Washington as broken, as hypocritical, as ridiculous as it is right now. Because I know the world must be watching and laughing and saying those stupid Americans. Remember the headline when Bush won a second term? The British newspapers actually said. Now we can see that 51% of Americans are stupid. So how stupid are we going to continue to be? Now let's look at the race in Virginia. Cuccinelli lost, and he just lost. The McAuliffe people won by 3%. That's what they were in their internal poll was polling. I don't know who thought it was going to be a runaway train. It might have been if the race was held right after the shutdown and the government was reopened, because then everybody thought the Republicans were actually stupid. And I don't know if Americans just kind of have amnesia real fast or they're just foolish. Because I would like to know, who are the 48%, whatever percentage it is in Virginia, that voted for Cuccinelli? With the crazy things that he said? And that Mr. W.J.W. Jackson person that ran for lieutenant governor, that black man who says the craziest things? Including that I think President Obama is not American. I wonder if we really believe that if President Barack Hussein Obama was born in Kenya, do you think he would still be president? Just put on your smart cap for a moment and think about that. Do you actually think that President Barack Obama would be our president, still got reelected in 2012, a year into his second term, and he was born in Kenya? Well, that means I'm running for president. If you believe that, I'm running for president. Seriously. How do we even continue to hear Republicans, Tea Partiers, and Republicans, some of them, the mainstream ones, including crazy Donald Trump, talking about the president, they're not sure? So if the NSA can tap the Chancellor of Germany's phone, don't you think they would kind of find out that he was really born in Kenya by now? Between the FBI, the CIA, the NSA, and all the A's and the I's, don't you think we would kind of know by now, people? Are you just about foolish among American people or what? Or are you just all listening to Rush Limbaugh? Who, he's one of those who still seems like he thinks President Obama was born in Kenya. Glenn Beck and the Fox crew. I'm seriously asking those people today. Do they really believe that all the agencies that we have in this country would allow President Barack Obama, the organizer that Palin likes to call him from Chicago, the socialist that Palin likes to call President Obama, do you think he would still be running this country? I just can't get my head wrapped around this. Because I just think it's foolish thought, crazy thought, stupid thought, and a waste of your energy and your time to continue down this journey. The majority of Republicans, a whole lot of Republicans, still believe that President Obama was born in Kenya. President Obama is a Muslim. I just can't wrap my head around this. I really can't. So let's go to New York and talk about the new mayor, de Blasio, who spoke in Spanish and English. Yeah, he sure did. I listened. I watched. I saw the genuine love between him and his wife and his children. And they're black and he looks white. Yeah, he does. So I wonder how Mr. de Blasio says he's going to do all these great things and equalize the population, income equality. I'm going, oh God, how are you planning to do this? So, Bloomberg was the rich people's mayor. De Blasio is now the poor people's mayor. Over 73% of New York voted for de Blasio That's a big, big, bigger than Christie victory. In the teens overage, like 13% more? So I am just kind of wondering and a little curious, how does a public advocate, Mr. de Blasio, now Mayor de Blasio of New York, take his campaign message and make it real? I've worked on lots of campaigns because I love politics. I think I should be a politician, but I don't like to lie, so I don't think I could be one. I'm just going to tell you the truth, just like Chris Christie, and sometimes you may not like it. Just like I do on my radio talk shows that I've all done, TV, I just can't lie. It's just difficult for me to lie. Really, it truly is. So I'm asking you folks, how do you take your political message? Because we all know we have to say things in a campaign that we know we really can't achieve. But we say it because lots of us are upset with President Obama because we think he was going to go to Washington and be the black people's president. And remember, he cannot be the black people's president because it was not just black people who voted for him. Because only black people voting for someone cannot make them president. So let's just get that in our cranium and stop hating President Obama for what he has not done for black people. Healthcare, I think, is one of the things he's done for black people, but he didn't just do it for black people. He did it for all the Americans who cannot go to the hospital if they're sick, don't have any healthcare plan. The one they have is crappy. And even when they think they have a good one, they can go to the hospital and told after 45 days that you are no longer covered, no matter the fact that you're in a coma. We don't care. We just want you to know that you're no longer covered. Oh, yes, and maybe you can just go and apply for Medicaid. The same Medicaid that 36 governors around the country decided not to expand under the Affordable Care Act. I simply ask you, how stupid are we as Americans? How foolish are we as Americans? How gullible are we as Americans? So do we really think that if the Democratic Party had gotten behind Bono, whatever weak candidate she is, or Bono, however she pronounced her name, in New Jersey, I think she did pretty well. She got over 700,000 votes. No. How many votes did she get? She got 780 something thousand votes, whatever. Okay. So if she had gotten some help, if her message had gotten out, if some of the governor's secrets had gotten out, what do you think would happen? Do you think that people are just thinking about Sandy at the moment? Do you think that Governor Christie is a caring, loving conservative? It's your thought. So let us not get ahead of ourselves. Because Governor Christie could not have won the way he did last night if it wasn't for people, Democrats, switching parties and voting for him. We don't know why they voted for him. And in the case of Virginia, everybody's talking about the guy who, the libertarian who got 7% of the vote, you know, if he wasn't there, Cuccinelli would have won. No, the exit poll showed that that vote would have been split. And I still want to know, who are the people voting for these Tea Party candidates? And the business people need to chide them too. We're going to do that when we come back in just a moment. We're going to come back in just a slither of a moment. Yes, we will come back in a moment. Hello to all my viewers. How are you? This is Diana Wright introducing you to my new book, Deadly Negligence, A True Story. It chronicles an astounding account of the magic of a mother's love, the power of divine miracles, and of course, Deadly Negligence will give you hope and inspiration, helping you get through anything that life throws your way. Get your copy today on Amazon.com. Thank you so much and have yourself a wonderful, blessed day. Remember, April 30th, 2014 is International I Love Me Day. I want you to start thinking about what will you do special for you on that day. Share it with me on Facebook and Twitter, and join the conversation on The Diana Wright Show, Monday through Friday, 10:30 a.m. We are live. The number to call, 561-228-1921. That's 561-228-1921. Join the conversation, like us on Facebook, and follow me on Twitter. Okay, we are back, and this is the Diana Wright Show live at 10:30. Tomorrow morning at 10:30, we promise you a very interesting show. We're going to have someone from Jamaica, and her name is Dr. Karen Carpenter. She is an intimacy expert, and she's going to join me tomorrow at 10:30 by Skype. So I promise you that that's going to be a very interesting conversation. Because you know me when it comes to intimacy and love and, you know, relationships and those things. I just like to talk about those things. Sex and, oh, divorce and breaking up to make up and all that kind of stuff. So her specialty is intimacy. And I would like for you to join us tomorrow morning at 10:30 when we will be talking to Dr. Carpenter. From Jamaica, she will join us live on the program. And also, I want to remind you that this Saturday, Anne-Marie and myself will be along with Chef Bunny at Auntie Merle's Kitchen in West Palm Beach. We're going to be there, and you can come and taste all the Jamaican food that you want to taste. And if you love it, you buy it. And hopefully, you'll buy some of my books, and hopefully, you'll buy some of Anne-Marie's products. So we're joining him to help him to get the word out about his restaurant. It's there. The food is good. He is a very pleasant man. We're just trying to help to move his business along. And also, if you're living in Broward, then, or maybe you want to drive to Broward, there's an Evening of Elegance, a college scholarship fundraising drive. And it's going to take place at the Sheraton Suites in Plantation Sunday, November 10th, starting at 4 o'clock. So you can go to that if you like to be part of the scholarship fund. And it is promising to be a great event. The Virtues will be there to sing for you. And Cheryl Rose Green will also be there. Mrs. Lillian Lincoln Lambert will be the keynote speaker. And the Reverend Dr. Jerry Gallimore will be the master of ceremonies. So join them at that event this Sunday, starting at 4 at the Sheraton Hotel in Plantation, right at the corner of University and Broward Boulevard. You can't miss it. It's not exactly at the corner, but you know what I mean. All right. And of course, coming up later on in November is November 17th. There will be the concert given by Dee and Miguel, My Redeemer Lives. That's a gospel concert coming up November 17. And that will be at the Palm Beach Lakes High School Auditorium, which I hear is a beautiful place. It's refurbished and done well. Refreshments will be there on sale, and they promise you a great concert. They will have Brother Paul, who I'm told is fantastic. His name is actually Marlon Anderson, but Brother Paul is what everyone knows him by. And then Brother Littell Gale and his group will be also there. They're called the Anointed Voices. So check them out on November 17th. Alrighty. let's get back here and talk about de Blasio. I just wanted to kind of figure out how he plans to do this equality thing. Because, you know, it's good to campaign on those things, but how do you govern, get that done, keep the crime rate where it is in New York? Yes, the stop and frisk thing is one of the things he campaigned on, and he is going to just get rid of that, which is easy because I've never understood that law. I really don't. And I don't think a lot of people understood it and why it targets minorities, mostly black people. And talking about black things, why is it that Black Friday is called Black Friday? Why isn't it called White Friday? That would be nice. I love white. White is actually my favorite color, if you call it a color. It is indeed a color. White is my favorite color, along with all the bright colors right now. But white, oh, you sleep on white sheets, you know, you just feel calm. White just kind of calms you. And then if you have something white in your closet for a long time and you haven't worn it and it's getting a little yellowy, all you need to do is just give it a little bleach, that Clorox, good old, just a tip in your water, and it's brand new. So, you know, or you just wash it. That's what I love about white. Okay? I truly, truly love white sheets, white clothing. It keeps you cooler in the hot times. Like right now, I'm being cooled. All right. So we're going to just kind of remind you of a few things here. Don't forget that April 30th is International I Love Me Day. I want you to think about what you're going to do for that day. I want you to love yourself every single day. Don't care what anyone thinks that you're high on yourself. Yes, you need to be high on yourself. Because if you're not high on yourself, there's no one will be high on you. And then you gotta receive the love that comes, give the love that comes. And don't forget that even though you see the future and you see the end of where you want to go, there will be some hell in the hallway to get there. All right? Just think about the middle. And don't give up in the middle, because the middle can be really hard. You're going, God, give me something easy. Please, I can't take this middle anymore. This hallway is too hot and too dangerous for me. I just need one of your miracles. Let it come easy to me, please. So, alrighty. Did you know there are luxury hotels in the world, like in Vienna and in New York, like in Waldorf Astoria, is like $10,000 a night for a room? What on earth do they have in those beds? Is that golden water that you're going to bathe with or something? They actually have hotels in the Middle East for $18,000 in Abu Dhabi. Yeah, $18,000 a night for one room. And then when I thought about $3,500, I thought that was plenty. No, it's not. It's cheap in comparison to $18,000. And that's all over the world. You just got to go in and look for it. It's incredible. Yeah, people afford that. But are you really just paying $18,000 a night to sleep in a bed? What is that bed made of? Is it the copy of the Queen's mattress that costs so many thousands of dollars? Is it all gold? I don't know. What is it that you're paying for $18,000? I just find it incredible to be paying $18,000 for a sleep in a bed at a night anywhere in the world. Well, if I get it for free, maybe I'll try it out. But I'm not so sure I would take my $18,000. That could actually buy me a Fiat. Seriously, that could buy me a Fiat and a whole lot of clothes from TJ Maxx marked down. Because I don't buy anything full price. I really try hard not to. If I buy something full price, it means that I must, and there's no choice for me to do that. All right? So I encourage you, ladies, try to look for sales and bargains. Because sometimes when you buy a dress and you got the dress for $40 and you look at the original price because it's there, it's in the sticker, and it's not lying because the sticker is there, and that dress was like $450, and I'm going, huh? It's only worth what I paid for it. So I'm encouraging you for this holiday season. Don't just go out and buy gifts and take some time to buy the gifts that you're going to buy. Put some thought into it and try not to pay full price. Please. And I don't know about this Black Friday thing, because I don't think I will ever get up out of my bed, try to get myself killed to get a deal. I don't do that kind of deal. My deals have to be deals that I go to the store, I watch the item at a big price, and it marks down to what I think I need to pay for it. All right, or what I can afford to pay. So that's just my little advice to all the ladies out there, especially because, you know, men, I don't think men know how to shop. Yeah. So all the ladies out there and the teenagers, when you're looking for a deal, make sure you're getting a bargain. And don't just go in and buy crap. Buy good stuff that lasts you and you can wear it for a long, long time. And it doesn't like thread away, you know. I see so much cheap clothes in the stores, and I just wonder, they're batting them out in China. Why can't we bring that manufacturing of making good quality clothes in America? That's my question. Good clothes are made in Italy? Yes, the best, but they are so expensive. So why can't we have someone somewhere make good quality clothes that stitches properly, so when you pull a string, it doesn't take the whole garment apart, and it's affordable? That's the kind of line that I would like to develop. The Diana Wright affordable brand. Not the Affordable Care Act, no, the Diana Wright affordable brand, yeah. And it would be very stylish and appropriate for your figure, because a lot of people, they have to wear everything that's in style, and sometimes it looks hideous on them. But they still insist on putting it on. Why do you do that? Not every style is for everyone. Some are good and some are bad. So let's stick to the styles that work for us, ladies, as we continue to say the magic words, I love me. And I want to give a shout out to Mr. Robinson today. A nice gentleman that I've actually not met yet, but I've spoken to him on the phone. He seems to be very talented, so I'm going to take him up on his offer to help make this show the blast and the hit that I want it to be. All right? So, hello, Mr. Robinson. Mr. Robinson goes to Washington. So, Mr. Robinson comes to the Diana Wright Show and make it not so crappy, but make it good. All right. Anyway, putting all jokes aside, we see that the brouhaha with Incognito and the guy Martin, Jonathan Martin, who was basically bullied out of being on the team, the Dolphins team in Miami. Now we hear that the coaches encouraged the bullying and the hazing, as they call it. Okay, now, who's lying? Incognito or the coaches? Did the coaches sanction it and ask Incognito to toughen up Martin because Martin didn't seem to be tough enough? Martin just looks like a sweet guy. He really does. I don't think he's made out for that kind of abuse. Tell you the truth, because bullying is abuse. And if the coaches were behind this, shame on you. Just like the coach that told his players to go out and injure other players, this kind of rings up right there, don't you think? Huh, give that some thought for today as you ponder your day of loving yourself. Okay. Let's see. Interesting fight going on between Mr. Colbert and Fox News. Because you see, Fox News had some doctor on there that was talking about Obamacare and talking about the fact that men under Obamacare, under the Affordable Care Act, is going to have to pay more for their coverage, because you do know that women normally have to pay more for their coverage because they have to deal with maternity, pediatrics, maternity leave, stuff like that. Yeah? Birth control? Other forms of birth control that we don't know about? Okay, so this doctor was saying, men don't have to worry about those things. All men have to worry about is their prostate. So why men should want to pay for what women do or what women have? And he went on to talk about women have vaginas and tubes and breasts. Huh? Excuse me? Now I wonder and I ponder. Who are the people that help to make the babies that are in the belly of those women? Who are the people who have sex and penetrate their wives or their significant other that they're not supposed to be doing that to? That's the politically correct thing to say. Who are those people that are doing that? Who are the people who kind of, sort of, are the parent of that child also? Who are the people that enjoy the breasts of women? Huh? Are you listening? Are you wondering? Why would this doctor be spousing that? Spewing that? Is he married? If I were his wife when he gets home, I would give him a clobber over his head. And Stephen Colbert is having a field day with it. Because he just can't wonder why he's wondering why this doctor is talking about women have vaginas and breasts and tubes and this and that and they cost more and why should you pay for them? Because we are your wives. We are your children's mother. We carry your babies. We give you sex whether we want to or not, whether we enjoy it or not, whether we get an orgasm or not. How about that, doctor? So why shouldn't a man and a woman pay the same for their health care? Because they don't have vaginas? And they only have a prostate and that's all they need to worry about? Well, yeah, now we find out by a new study that the testosterone that all of you men are trying to build up, men are actually having heart attacks and all those things from those treatments. So my advice? Live with a low T and just get your brain in gear. Start being romantic. Start loving and showing your wife you love her. Start doing things for her. And not always expecting her to do for you. How about that? Well, I hope Dr. Carpenter will be able to talk about that tomorrow in terms of intimacy. Because how do you become intimate? How do you show your wife you love her? What is the prerequisite to letting her know that you want to have some sex tonight? How does that work? I'm sure we'll talk about that tomorrow. Hope she's brave enough to take my questions. As you know me, I could go. So for that doctor on Fox, please. Men don't just have prostate. Yes, they have that. But they are the contributors to the vagina producing a baby that creates maternity and pediatrics and everything else. And those tubes are part of the process. And those breasts are part of the process. Because, you know, some men just love breasts. How about that? I could not believe when I saw that going online. It was just ridiculous. And it's not good for me to switch from that to this, but I am going to anyway because I just love Pope Francis. Because Pope Francis is doing great things. Pope Francis making new waves again. And of course, this was written by a reporter online, and I just thought this was so funny that he is now launching a survey of his flock on issues facing the modern families, from gay marriage to divorce. Very specific questions are being sent to parishioners, yes, to the different parishes around the globe, in preparation for next year's synod, however you pronounce it, of bishops, a grassroots effort that experts say is unprecedented. Oh yeah. So we're going to take a short break right now and come back in just a moment and talk about that for a minute, because let me tell you something. Pope Francis is my guy. Love him, love him. I think he's right for the time we're going through right now. Back in a moment. Hello, everyone. This is a season of giving, and I'm asking you to consider one of your gifts to be Deadly Negligence, written by yours truly, Diana White. A story that will give you hope, make you mad, shock you sometimes, but is bound to increase your faith and make you believe in miracles again. So please, give Deadly Negligence as a gift, as the gifting season begins to heat up. I am depending on you to do this for me. Thank you so much, and be the proud person to give a gift of the book, Deadly Negligence. It's available on Amazon.com and on my website, DianaWhiteTV.webs.com. Thank you so much for my viewers around the world and in the United States. Be blessed. Hello, everyone. It doesn't matter who you are, how rich you are, how poor you are. But there has to be a point in your life, and you will come to that point, where you have to take someone you love to the hospital. But have you ever considered that you could take that loved one, in my case, my only child, to the hospital in a normal state? And then you leave 5 months later, brain damaged, in a wheelchair, without your senses. This is my true story, Deadly Negligence, the book, available on Amazon and at my website, DianaWhiteTV.webs.com. I'm asking you today to get a copy. Support my story. Let us get this out there, because this story will captivate you. It will shock you. It will give you hope. It will increase your faith and make you believe in miracles again. Thank you for picking up your copy today. And just in case you know Oprah Winfrey or Tyler Perry or Mr. Levinson, let them know this is worth a movie. Thank you. Get your copy today. Alrighty, we are back, and this is the Diana White Show Live. We thank you so much for joining us from around the world and in the United States. We give you news, we talk about sex, we talk about love, and we encourage you to love yourself, the most important thing you can do for yourself. And we ask you to follow us on Facebook and on Twitter. Twitter is going public, did you know? Yeah, and they're gonna plan to give you some advertising here, there, and everywhere. I don't know how many times, how many things can we get pressed with advertising? I don't know. If you want your product to sell, you just have to advertise it. You just got to push it. You got to push it. You got to work on it. And oh my goodness, oh, there's hell in the hallway. Yeah, there is hell. We got to deal with that hell. Because you know, for me, nothing comes easy. I would just ask God, give me a miracle easy. Make it easy. Because the middle has been hellish. I can see what I want at the end there. Yes, I see the crowds. I see the people. But take me from the hell now. I know lots of you out there who are struggling with something or going through a hard time or just down on yourself or whatever it is. You are saying to yourself, God, please give me something easy. Let it not be that I'm worried about my house. not paying my mortgage, my house being taken away, my car being taken away. I don't have food to feed my children. And if I'm sick, I can't go to the doctor because I have no insurance. Please, God, give me something easy. So yes, we all go through trials and tribulations. But if we only believe and trust and take action to do what we can do and leave the rest to God, as they say, let go and let God, we will be so happy. But it's so hard to not try to do it yourself. It's so hard to not try to fix it yourself. It's so hard to be patient and wait on God. But yes, he has sent us Pope Francis. And this is some of the comments that people are making about the fact that he's going to be launching this survey and sending it to all the parishes around the globe. People are saying it's fascinating. That was said by Thomas Groom, a professor of theology at Boston College. It's pretty astonishing, agreed Marion Duddy Burke, executive director of the gay Catholic organization Dignity USA. Vatican watchers say Francis' polling attempt is extraordinary on two levels. First, because it seeks input from ranking and file Roman Catholics, and second, because it touches on issues that might have been considered off limits in past papacies. So you see, Pope Francis, we love you. And we love you because you are willing to be open, speak the truth, and not be obsessed with abortion and contraceptives and women's reproductive rights and gay people. So we love you for that. Because I truly believe that you are a man of God. And you are planning and you are anointed to bring people into the Catholic Church. And despite all the bad things that we know have happened in the Catholic Church that was pushed under the rug, he's willing to face it head on. He wants to know, why did you leave the Catholic Church? How can I get you to come back to the Catholic Church? That's a good, humbling thing for most ministers to learn. When you lose your flock, you need to find out why, and don't be offended by what they tell you is the reason why. Because if you don't want to hear the reason, don't ask. You know, people ask you, why are you upset? And why do you this? And why do you that? But when you tell them, they get offended because they don't want to hear the truth. And for me, the Bible tells you the truth will set you free, and I do believe that from the depth of my soul. That's the reason I tell you, I would need fixing. I would love to be on Yanla's show to be fixed myself, because there are things that I need to be fixed about. No one is perfect, but we all have our passion, we all have our purpose, and we all should pursue them. My purpose right now, apart from bringing my daughter back to where she's supposed to be, with the grace of God, is to get you, each and every one of you, male and female, to love yourself first. Because if you love yourself first every single day, no matter what you're going through and who you hate, the hate for that person will be gone. Because you have to spend time on the love part instead of the hate part. So I continue. The document sent to every nation's conference of bishops notes that the ancient church and its members are grappling with, quote, concerns which were unheard of until a few years ago. Same-sex unions, mixed marriages, single-parent families, and surrogate mothers are all mentioned in the prelude to a list of questions that get into the nitty-gritty of 21st century life. Now, we might not all like gay people getting married? That's not my thing. But are we going to try to kill all gay people and say we're Christians? I'm not into the single parenting thing because I don't think I can be a father because I'm a woman. But are we going to kill all single parents? No, we're not. Are we going to be obsessed with the female vagina and their reproductive rights and preventing them from having abortions if they want to? Who do you think is going to speak to God when judgment day comes? It's them, not you. So you love the people, you don't love the sin that you think they're committing. Isn't that the way we're supposed to be? I will love you at a distance if I have to. I refuse to hate you and I refuse to keep malice. But if you decide to keep malice with me, it's okay. If I see you, I'll say, hi, how are you? With a smile too. And I still love you, but you have to hear my truth. And if you choose malice, that's okay too. Because that's your life, not mine. It's yours. It's yours for the taking and the keeping. So let us think about the hell in the hallway and the middle of our lives. Even though we see where we're going, you don't want to get it too muddled. You don't want to get too many haters around you. You want to just move forward in the plan. Yeah? So, here are some of the questions. What pastoral attention can be given to people who live in these types of same-sex union? Pastors out there who hate homosexuals, and though they hate them, they're doing it too, like Eddie Long, allegedly so. Remember those days. That's not too long ago. In the case of unions of persons of the same sex who have adopted children, what can be done pastorally in light of transmitting the faith? So instead of trying to kill a gay person who adopts a child who needs a parent and the gay person just happened to have enough money to take care of that child, what do? Are we going to help them, encourage them, and teach them the right way? Or are we just going to be down on them? Like some of you out there who are criticizing my show, are you going to help to make it better? Or are you just going to criticize them? If you're just going to criticize and do nothing to help, shut up. Don't want to hear from you. But if you're willing to give love and want to be a part of this process that will can only grow, I welcome you. I don't want haters or negative people around me. I don't care who you are. So, and if you keep malice, I don't. I will still love you despite your keeping malice. Because once I reach out, it means I've gotten over whatever it was that the dispute was about. Even if I am walking out of your room and you're giving away my position to someone else, I forgive you. Yeah, I do. Okay. Do the divorced and remarried feel marginalized or suffer from the impossibility of receiving the sacraments? In cases where non-practicing Catholics or declared non-believers request the celebration of marriage, describe how this pastoral challenge is dealt with. Oh, Pope Francis, you are just awesome. The survey is the latest sign of Francis's willingness to engage ordinary Catholics and promote a less judgmental approach to hot button social issues. Now that's the story that is my wow for the week. Yeah, the elections, that's a wow. But that, for me, is great, is fantastic. How do we work with those who are not like us? How do we love those who are not like us? How do we get to those who are not like us? How do we not discard those who are not like us? I remember when I used to do my show in Jamaica, taping there, the Diana Wright Show, and I needed people from the ghetto, I would get in my car, drive to the hood, and people would say, "You're crazy! You're going to Trenchtown!" Yes, I'm going to Trenchtown, because I do believe that when people watch my show, they feel that I speak the truth, they feel that I'm genuine, and they feel that I truly, truly want them to love who they are. Yeah, because you see, the people that I got to come on my show that were from the ghetto, lots of people were shocked when they saw them. And yes, when I went to Trenchtown, or when I went to Harborview, or when I went to Port Royal, and I walked around, every television set that was playing my show, the Diana Wright Show. So how can you not love everybody? How can you not embrace everybody? And people who think I'm not humble, I am one of the most humble people that you'll meet. Ego? No. Forget that. I'm just not there. I love what I do. I want to do it on a bigger platform. But this is what I have right now. And until God gives me the other platform that I'm accustomed to, like television in America and around the world, this is what we work with. So work with what you have until you get to where you want to go. Don't give up. And if you love something, set it free. If it comes back, it's yours. If it doesn't, it was never yours. I thank you so much for joining me today. I hope that you were blessed or you were lifted up by something I said. Even the three magic words, as simple as they may sound. I love me. And mean it. Take care. Ciao. Count your blessings. And tomorrow is another day. Live in the present.